Penguin Random House Audio presents Book, Line, and Sinker by Jenn McKinlay. Read for you by Allyson Ryan. Chapter 1.
Daisy Buchanan was an insipid, shallow, soulless woman, Violet LaRue declared. Jay should have found someone else.
But he loved her, Nancy Peyton argued.
Why? Violet asked. She shuddered. The woman was a horror.
She was old money, Lindsey Norris said. She was everything that the new money, like Jay Gatsby, aspired to be. It was lunchtime on Thursday at the Briar Creek Public Library, where the crafternoon group met every week to work on a craft, eat yummy food, and talk about their latest read. Per usual, Violet and Nancy were the first to arrive. Lindsey was the director of the library, and this group had been one of her ideas to boost the popularity of the library in town.
Buchanan was a bully. Remember when Daisy had that bruise? Nancy asked. What kind of man treats a woman like that?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I've dated him. Well, men just like him at any rate, Beth Stanley said as she waddled into the room.
Beth was the children's librarian, and today she was dressed as a giant green caterpillar, the puffy underbelly of which seriously impeded her ability to walk. Dangling from one arm, she held a large basket of plastic fruit and foodstuffs. Lindsey lowered the sampler she was attempting to cross-stitch and studied Beth. Don't tell me, let me guess, she said. Today you read Eric Carle's The Very Hungry Caterpillar. What? Mary Murphy exclaimed as she stepped over the tail end of Beth's costume to enter the room. I thought we were reading F. Scott Fitzgerald's The Great Gatsby.
We are, Nancy said. Beth read the Caterpillar book to her story time crowd.
Oh, phew, you had me worried there, Mary said as she plopped into the chair beside Lindsey.
Well, you might want to take a gander at some of the picture books, Nancy said.
Her look was sly.
You know, if you and Ian ever decide to have some babies.
Mary tossed her long, dark curls over her shoulder and sent Nancy a grin. My husband is all the baby I can handle at the moment, thank you very much. Although things seem to be progressing nicely between Lindsey and Sully, so perhaps you'll have some luck there.
Ouch!
Lindsey jammed her thumb into her mouth, trying to ease the hurt from the round-tipped needle where it had jabbed her skin.
Interesting, Nancy said,
giving Lindsey a piercing look. Food's here, Charlene LaRue announced as she stepped into the room, bearing a tray of mini bagel sandwiches paired with cucumber cups stuffed with feta and a carafe of lemonade. Like her mother, Violet, Charlene was a tall, beautiful black woman with warm brown eyes and a smile that lit up the room. But while Violet had been a stage actress, Charlene was a local news anchor. Lindsey always marveled that she was able to balance her public life, be an exemplary wife and mother, and still make time for their crafternoon Thursdays. Nancy turned her attention away from Lindsey and tucked her cross-stitched needle into the corner of her canvas cloth. She leaned forward to help herself to the food on the tray Charlene was setting out on the table.
How is Sully? Violet asked. I haven't seen him in ages.
Violet and Nancy were not only best friends, but also tag team buddies in the information-seeking game. Where one left off, the other stepped in.
Did you know that The Great Gatsby is considered the greatest American novel? Lindsey asked.
There she goes, changing the subject, Beth said.
She shimmied out of her caterpillar costume and hung it up on the coat rack. The static from the costume made her short, spiky black hair stand up on end, and she ran her fingers through it in a futile attempt to tame it. She grabbed her project bag from where she'd tucked it into her fruit basket and took the last remaining seat in the room.
I am not, Lindsey said. I'm just keeping us on task. We're supposed to work on a craft while we discuss our latest book, which is
The Great Gatsby,
the rest of the ladies said together. We know, Charlene said. It's just that you've been dating Sully for a few months now, so we're curious. Can we assume it's going well?
Lindsey glanced at Mary for backup, thinking that since she was Sully's sister, surely she wouldn't want to hear about his love life, but no. She nodded at Lindsey encouragingly. Lindsey just shook her head. Her crafternoon buddies were incorrigible.
"Hey, that's not your granny's cross-stitch," Beth declared, looking at the cross-stitch hoop in Lindsey's lap. "I love that."
"Well, we did say we were doing subversive cross-stitch," Lindsey said. She glanced at her sampler, which when she was done would read, "Books are my homeboys," with a border of books on bookshelves going around it. She planned to hang it in her office, if she ever stopped stabbing herself in the thumb, because even with a round-tipped cross-stitch needle, it still hurt when it poked the skin.
"You need a thimble," Violet said. "You're a hazard with that needle."
"I have an extra."
Mary reached into her bag and handed one to Lindsey.
"So what do yours say?" Lindsey asked the group.
"Mine says, bake your own damn cookies," Nancy said.
Lindsey laughed. Nancy was not just her crafternoon buddy, but also her landlady. After 60-odd years of living in Briar Creek, Nancy had come to be known for her cookie-baking skills, which occasionally annoyed her, as she had also become the go-to gal for cookie exchanges and bake sales. Violet held up her cross-stitch, and in her best stage voice she read,
"To be or not to be, that is not the question. The question is, what time is lunch?"
Nancy snorted and gave Violet a high five. "I went with an old restaurant standby," Mary said. "Kiss my grits." Mary and her husband Ian owned the Blue Anchor Cafe, the only restaurant in town that just happened to serve the best clam chowder in New England.
"Love it," Beth said. "Hang it by the cash register."
"Mine is going in our master bathroom," Charlene said. She held up a pretty cross-stitch with a half-finished border of red swirls. It read, "Cap on, seat down, or else." Mary cracked up and said, "If I pay you, will you make me one just like it?" Lastly, Beth held up hers. It too had a pretty pink border, and in the middle it displayed curse symbols.
"Oh, no, you didn't," Charlene said with a delighted giggle.
"Yes, I did," Beth said. "I wanted to drop in some really rough language, but I thought this was pithier and more imaginative."
"I think Fitzgerald would approve," Nancy said. "I do love his way with words. Do you remember how Nick describes Gatsby?" He smiled understandingly, much more than understandingly. It was one of those rare smiles with a quality of eternal reassurance in it that you may come across 4 or 5 times in life.
"Lovely," Mary said, "but you can't help but feel that Gatsby will be disappointed."
"Which brings us to the biggest question in the book. Do you think Daisy was guilty of the hit and run and Jay took the blame for her, or no?" Beth asked.
A knock on the doorframe interrupted the conversation. It was Anne Marie, a part-time worker for the library. She was somewhere in her 40s, the mother of 2 rambunctious boys, and favored denim skirts and soft jersey shirts. As she explained it to Lindsey, keeping up with her boys took all of her energy, so she did not own any clothing that required ironing. She wore narrow black-framed glasses and was growing out her short brown hair, which had hit the awkward stage of many lengths and was held in place by a handful of hairpins.
"I hate to interrupt," she said, "but there seems to be an altercation happening out front."
Lindsey hopped to her feet.
"What sort of altercation?"
"Mostly it's a yelling match," Anne Marie said, "between Milton Duffy and Trudy Hargrave."
Milton? The crafternooners exchanged baffled looks. Milton Duffy was a yogi. He didn't yell.
"Excuse me," Lindsey said.
"Holler if you need backup, boss," Beth called.
Lindsey nodded and hurried from the room.
Chapter 2.
Lindsey could hear the raised voices before she stepped into the library. Standing in the main lobby with the entire library watching them were Milton Duffy and Trudy Hargrave. They were both trying to outshout each other, and both were gesturing wildly.
Lindsey thought they looked like two wild turkeys trying to intimidate each other with their squawking and ruffled feathers.
It's a slap in the face of all that the Historical Society represents.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.